Guys, it's been so long since we got a chance to do this, but one more time for the people in the back, let's do this! You remember the words. Sing at home! Stagers, it's fucking Stagers, Jer's fucking Star Wars, Jerry and Jer. Stagers, it's fucking Stagers, Jer's fucking Star Wars, Jerry and Jer. Because, ladies and gentlemen, a long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, well, Ring's End, kind of, two Jers got together to discuss all things Star Wars on the Page 180 podcast. And joining me, as always, my Jerry, my part Jer in crime. There you go. All the Jer puns. I'm using all the puns that have been used on me previously. It is the one and only Jerry Soul. Very welcome back to Page 180. Jerry, how's things? It's been too long.
It's certainly been a minute. Absolutely, it's been a minute. Yes, getting on great. Very well. I won't say promotion, but kind of new responsibilities and things like that, and looking to get a promotion in a couple of months now as well. So yeah, everything's going well. Family as well. We're getting a new dog.
Nice.
Well, we will be, just we don't know when.
Nice.
So we'll be getting a new dog. So we have Chewy, obviously.
Of course, Chewy. Yeah. Yeah.
But I had to. We already have the new dog named.
Right.
Whatever we get. And I had to bring a little, because obviously I'm a big Star Wars guy, but I had to bring a little bit of the Lord of the Rings in, you know, because
okay.
I'm big. So
yeah.
He's going to be Bilbo.
Love it.
So it's
Love
going
it.
to be Chewy and Bilbo. So
Love
delighted with
it.
that. But yeah, everything's going well. We had a nice quiet Christmas. And I know a lot of people say that, but then they don't. Like, no, I cooked a dinner this year. It was the first time cooking Christmas dinner. And then I just sat down on the couch and played games.
That
And
is a perfect Christmas.
It was amazing, because I got myself one of these. The missus bought me one of them. It's a Pow Kitty.
Ooh.
A Pow Kitty, 20,000 retro games. And I haven't even scratched the surface of it yet. They're absolutely fantastic.
I
And
love it.
the amount of Star Wars and Star Wars, Star Trek, every nerdy, every, like, there's about 50 different Batman games on it, which is
Nice.
amazing. But yeah, it's absolutely fantastic. I love it.
Unbelievable. Good stuff. Jerry, we were having a chat beforehand because obviously we're recording this on the night that the news broke, and I was discussing it earlier in the pod about how obviously Low Blows is coming back to the Woolshed.
What's that?
You were obviously a day oneer, as you were quick to point out
Yes,
in
I
our
fucking
discussion.
was. Yes.
Jerry is the only person to have been involved in Low Blows that like was involved from start to finish of when we originally wrapped the company in 2021. We break some news, will we? We tell
yeah,
them.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Okay. Okay, let's go. Well, look, if you don't want it, we can edit it out afterwards. But like, I can exclusively reveal, we've literally just signed the deal. Jerry's back in Low Blows. I love it. I'm so happy.
For a substantial pay increase on my
he
lab.
Has. He's
You
very
did agree
expensive
to that.
These days.
You did agree to that.
It is Comic-Con's Jerry that I'm getting here. Like, so, yeah. Dublin Comic-Con host and all. So, like, yeah, this is... but, yeah, really exciting times. And I know people would be delighted to hear that. It's... we're back. We're all coming back. The band is back together.
I can hear the dings coming in on your computer there for refunds already, and you're like, "Yeah, we haven't even released tickets yet. How we can ask for refunds?" Yeah, no, I'm very happy to be back. It's obviously something that we did for a very, very long time. I was very sad. Obviously, we were sad when COVID came along because we weren't able to do them, and then of course we wrapped up after that. Then, and as I said to you before we came on, I kind of like had the inkling in my head. I've been kind of liking wrestling again, and I'm like, well, I just send him a message. Just send him, go on, give him a little nudge. But it's the fact that it's actually you giving me the nudge. So yes,
yeah.
I'm very happy to be back. It's gonna be great, and I'm really, really looking forward to it. So I'm looking forward to seeing everybody back home in the Woolshed, place that we were there for so long. It's been so many years since we were there, and we're back home in the Woolshed. All we need now is a shout out to Ed. All is forgiven. Come home. All is forgiven. Come home, Ed.
Hey, who knows?
I tell you, that would be the cherry on the
Imagine,
cake.
I'd
Would
cry.
have Ed there.
I would cry if Ed
You know what?
Showed
You
up.
know what? I'm going to send him a message. We're gonna get this done. Let's get it done.
There you go, guys. It's happening. The band is back together. Yeah, amazing. Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, I think we were all kind of getting the itch, and it was everything was just pointing towards this, and it was just a case of me and Wolchek getting in the same room, and they were very much the same page, and it was like, let's just do this. Like, let's stop being silly here. This is perfect. Everyone wants this, so let's go. It's going to be unreal. But Jerry, we're not here to talk about wrestling. We're not here to talk about Woolshed. We're not here to talk about life. So let's talk. We're here to talk about one very thing. We're the Star Jairs, and we're back to talk about Star Wars, because Disney Plus released the latest series, the final series of the Bad Batch 3-episode premiere, released this week. We're obviously huge fans of that show, and we've discussed it before on page 180, but now we're kind of going to get to give it its own space, because it's the only Star Wars property out now. But there's a lot going on since we last talked in the Star Wars world. And first thing is, a person that gets a lot of airtime and is spoken about, now he's not technically is like involved loosely with this project and all projects now, but it's not necessarily his show, but someone we always talk about and give credit to is Dave Filoni, obviously the creator of Star Wars Rebels, the Clone Wars, Star Wars properties that we truly love and have a special place in our heart, and then obviously Mandalorian, Ahsoka most recently, which we discussed last year in the last kind of iteration of Star Jairs. Since then, he's been named the Chief Creative Officer of Star Wars, and announced that a Mandalorian movie was announced, as well as season 2 of Ahsoka. A lot of interesting takes around this. People are, you know, there's the likes of ourselves who are massive Filoni fans, and there's a lot of people who are, you know, crying out for this for the longest amount of time. They've given someone who, again, we've kind of likened in the show previously to a Kevin Feige figure in Star Wars, but they've given him the Kevin Feige keys to the kingdom. And now he gets to kind of make it in his vision. A lot of other people are saying, yeah, but, you know, Mando, the last series wasn't great. Ahsoka was a bit hit and miss at times. Book of Boba Fett, kind of a flop. Although I really liked it when it was good. What are your thoughts? How's this sitting with yourself?
So when I first heard this, I literally jumped for joy, because the way I see it is, he is the rightful heir to Star Wars, really. He is the chosen. He is the chosen one. Let's be perfectly honest with you. And I think the MCU has proved one thing, is that when you have one person at the top overseeing everything, that's what's best. Because when you have one person, you look at the sequel trilogy. If you had one person overseeing all three movies, like a George Lucas, even if there was different directors, you would still have somebody there saying, no, we can't do that. You have to, no, let's go back to here. You know, there would have been a bit more coherency between the three films. Whereas you go from one into The Last Jedi, and they're like, okay, well, this is all changed. And then you go into the third one, and they're like, oh, we're back to what we were at the start, but it was kind of ruined from the previous one, like all over the place. When you have someone like a Kevin Feige, it just makes things better. Like, look at the success of those first 21 movies in the MCU. It was just stellar. So to have somebody like Filoni being the George Lucas of Star Wars now, I think it's what's best. Now, I know people are saying, oh, well, listen, the last season of Mando wasn't very good. Ahsoka, as you say, Ahsoka was hit and miss. I loved Ahsoka. I thought it was absolutely fantastic. Ahsoka has given me a character. I didn't think I would have a new character get into my top five of all-time favorite characters in Star Wars. They have. And the fact that we'll never actually see that character again. We'll see the character, but it'll be a different iteration of the character, which was Baylan Skull. I just thought that the performance of Ray Seems was just fantastic. I've said it multiple times on this podcast. He was amazing. I never thought I'd love another Star Wars character as much as I loved the likes of the Emperor and Vader. But along comes Baylan Skull. I'm like, oh my God, love this guy. Absolutely brilliant. Yes, okay. Was there parts of it that were slightly hit and miss? Yes. And I don't think anyone's just going to disagree with that. Yeah. But I think at the end of the day, it lived up to the hype. It was very good. We got Anakin back. Probably going to get him back again, probably for more stuff. Let's be honest. So I thought, you know, all the stuff that's coming out about him and oh well, you know, we're not happy with this. No. You just need to give him time. You know, right? Alex Ferguson wasn't successful from his first fucking season, was he? No, he wasn't. He had to give the person time. You have to give them time to breathe, sit into the new role, and then you will get all this amazing, astonishing stuff. Now, when we got the announcement, so we got Ahsoka Season 2 announcement and we got the Mando movie announcement, I was like, yes, well, obviously we're going to get, you know, Ahsoka Season 2 announcement. But it wasn't so much alarm bells, but a lot of questions going off in my head when I saw the movie for Mando. I'm like, wait, are we not getting a season 4?
Mm.
Why are we not getting a season 4? I know a lot of people weren't happy with season 3, and I think we can kind of understand why season 3 wasn't the same epicness as season 1 and 2, because Filoni wasn't really around that much. He was off trying to get Ahsoka off the ground, trying to get that filmed. He wasn't really there the way he would have been in the previous seasons. So it wasn't the full kind of Favreau-Filoni mix. It was more Favreau and other people doing a few things. So you were never going to get that full feel of season 1 and season 2. Was it the worst thing in the world? Of course it wasn't. It was still good bits in it. There was some shite, but you know, there's no series in the entire history of television or movies that's like this perfect all the way through. It's just not. Well, Clone Wars. You can't fault the Clone Wars. You just can't. There's no way. But you know, just let the man cook. He is now the chief creative. It's like within a year we got him as chief creative of Star Wars. He was Triple H chief creative of wrestling. I'm like, of WWE. I'm like, yeah, I'm very happy with this. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So very, very happy with it. We just have to let him cook. That's all you have to do. Just let's see how it goes.
Yeah.
It's, you know, Star Wars is not going to go the way of DC and the absolute shite mess that's in. You just give him time and he'll bring it all together. And it's going to be brought together in such an epic way that we will get an Endgame style movie. We will get an Endgame style ending. And it's going to be glorious. You're going to have everyone go, this is fucking beautiful. Oh, this is beautiful. I'm telling you, just let the man cook and he will get us there.
Yeah. Like, again, yeah. Has there been some hit and misses? Yeah. Is there. Will I miss him? Again, the problem is, right, Kevin Feige gets Marvel, okay? But he doesn't write the movies. Do you know what I mean? And that's what Dave Filoni is really good at. He can direct, he can write, he can do live action, he can do animated. I think that's what people are more scared of, that it's like, oh, like we don't get to see him do the things that he wants to do. Now, I'm sure he will dip in and out. Like Ahsoka, he pretty much said, this is my baby, I'm doing all of it. And I get it. And it was great when he did it. The highs were really high in Ahsoka, which we loved. And again, there wasn't perfect, but it was okay. But again, I'm okay. I'm optimistic with this. Like, I think it's, you've got a high floor with Dave Filoni, because he's never going, he loves Star Wars too much to ever allow it to be shit. You know, so he's not going to sell out. He's not going to do that. Was I a bit concerned at the announcement of a Mando movie? I'm going to be honest, yeah. Because I'm like, this feels totally out of the blue. It feels like a cash-in opportunity. It feels reactive. Doesn't feel like anything was building towards this. Whereas we spoke before about how it did feel like the different series were converging upon each other. But I felt like when we got a movie, we'd be ready for it. But look, I'll give it a shot. And like, again, Mando wasn't an awful show last season. It was just a step down from being a fucking amazing show, which so was disappointment we responded to rather than the actual quality of the show. So again, no doubt it's the same creators who made it amazing. So I'm more than happy to give them a chance to win it back. One person who unfortunately won't be in the Mando movie is Greef Karga, one character played by the one and only Carl Weathers, who recently passed away. Obviously an icon for so many different roles. You're talking everything from, you know, Rocky to Predator. You know, you've got Happy Gilmore. You've got, like, you know, even in recent years, you had him in The Mandalorian. Obviously, he'd become a Star Wars legend. It's going to be so weird to think that we're getting a Mandalorian movie where we won't hear Mando at all. Thoughts on the late Carl Weathers and kind of the loss that we have, like, both in Star Wars and just in the acting world in general.
It was a huge shock, obviously. to put it into perspective, I had found out a couple of days before he died that he was due to be here on the 9th and 10th of March for Dublin Comic Con. And I was so excited. I was like, oh, this is going to be great. Because I knew one of the head guys in Dublin Comic Con. He's a huge Predator fan. A lot of them, a lot of the guys are. And they've been trying to get Carl over for, I think it was 7 years. And just the schedules never coincided. And then finally the schedule, we're going to sign a contract, going to come over. The day it was announced, people were going crazy. My God, Carl, this is going to be fantastic. And within a couple of hours, I get a message saying, have you seen the news? I'm like, yeah, I know. It's great. Carl, no, that's not the news. I'm like, what? And I checked it out. And we found out that he had died. It was such a shock. And he's such an amazing actor. You look at everything that he's been in. And, you know, it's hard to fathom that someone as big as him is actually gone. It is one of those shockers. Unfortunately, actors, you know, people die a lot, and it happens throughout every single year. And you're like, Jesus, that's sad, isn't it? But when you hear somebody like him, you're like, it's a kind of gut punch. You're like, Jesus Christ, this is he's a big guy. The fact that we've seen him, and he looked amazing in The Mandalorian. You think he's just going to be, you know, people like him are just going to be around forever, and unfortunately they weren't. So obviously it was a huge loss to Star Wars, huge loss to his fans and friends and family around the world. So obviously our thoughts are with them. It is such a devastating loss, really, because he was a fantastic character in Star Wars. He was a fantastic actor, and he will be very, very sorely missed. Very sorely missed.
What I loved about watching Carl Weathers perform was, and I mean this in the best way, you always were aware of him acting, if that made sense. You know what I mean? He was never he was never going to do any kind of Oscar best actor reels or anything like that with dramatic emotion and stuff like that. There was always a bit of hamminess to him, if it makes sense. But I mean it in the best way, because he was like, he's a throwback to an old school movie star, because he's just very like, he's not afraid to act and be charismatic and say things in the most dramatic or funny or entertaining, whatever. Like, he will maximize every line that he has and every opportunity. And it's just so charming and likable. He was just a big presence on the screen in every role that he was in, from Apollo Creed onwards. Like, and yeah, it's just, again, we felt so blessed to have him as Greve Karga in the Mandalorian universe, because we just get another run with Carl Weathers. It's just such a treat. And that's how I felt watching him act. It was a treat. It was watching someone just that you wanted to just have a beer with, just cook and be charismatic and be likable. And in a way, like, I know I'm saying that, like, it wasn't necessarily realistic. And again, that's not a bad thing, because not every acting role needs to be that. You know what I mean? Acting can be fun, and it can be entertaining, and it can be glitzy and stuff, and that's the style that he brought. But I also believe that that was realistic for him, and that was the way he carried on in his day-to-day life. I believe he just seemed like this larger-than-life character. Some of the quotes coming out as well are extremely profound. I read one out there the other week to wrap up the show on page 180, and obviously a great thinker as well, and, you know, just such a devastating loss, not only to Star Wars, but to the acting community, and obviously most importantly to his family and friends and the people that are most affected by him. So rest in peace, Carl Weathers, and thank you for all of the memories, all decades of them. What an absolute legend. He will be missed. But anyway, let's get on to it. We're here to discuss The Bad Batch. If you don't watch The Bad Batch, what are you listening here for? This was clearly signposted that we're going to be talking about The Bad Batch. We are into the spoilerverse. We go on Star Jers. So again, this is not a spoiler-free zone. You will get spoiled. If you haven't seen the episodes, go away, watch them. if you have to catch up from the start, do it. It's well worth it. This is a great show. But again, we are going to talk about spoilers. We're going to theorize. We're going to talk about everything in Star Wars up to date. We may talk about some comic canon. We may talk about some stuff from outside, video games, whatever. It's all on the table. So don't add us. We gave you fair warning. So let's talk about the Bad Batch, the 3-episode premiere of the third and final season. But before we get into that, well, as we always do, when we're here on Star Jairz or into the spoilerverse on page 180, we are going to recap the 3 episodes that we just watched in our alt recap. And we begin... No, we don't. That didn't work. How embarrassing. hold on. Take two. This would never happen, Carweathers. This would never, ever happen.
He'd have punched through the camera at this point.
He'd have genuinely killed me. He'd have just like thought it and be gone. Yay! I'm leaving all that in. And on Mount Tatnus, aka Star Wars Jurassic Park, life has found a way for Omega to give Crosshair a redemption arc while feeding her favorite lurker-towned Batcher chicken nuggets. The Empire is keeping them all hostage as part of a project to replace midichlorians, to replicate midichlorians, but are falling flat. Dr. Hemlock is putting the mid in midichlorian, clearly. Unfortunately, nuggets can do a lot, but they can protect pets against abusive prick droids. So she decides to free Batcher, who big bad Dr. Hemlock tries to convince her is now more vulnerable as a result, but as we see at the end of the episode, he's made it to safety. It'd be a really emotional moment if the name Batcher didn't sound like the type of name Fran would bash down the pub in an episode of Love Hate. Meanwhile, Hunter and Wrecker are trading in pikes to Lady Durant, who takes a break from sending her captains out of her Star Wars moon door to assist our defective heroes. They end up on a wild goose chase to a destroyed old Empire lab, but encounter some young red clones hanging out named Mox, Zeke, and Stack. And they have an adventure together, dodging slithering vines until Clone Force 99 drop them off at Pabu. Mox, Zeke, Stack, Hunter, and Wrecker, they sound like a death metal band your dad was in the 90s, named Slithering Vines. But okay, episode 2 just kind of happened. It gets good again anyway in episode 3 after Nala Se. And Jerry, I don't know, did you ever know Nala Se's full name? It's actually Nala Se Nala Sala Matusa. So there you go. There's a fun fact for you. Dad jokes are back on Star
I'm not doing this show anymore.
Yeah, anyway, she tips Omega off that she's in trouble if they find out she has a high midichlorian count and tells her to escape. Fortunately, they're distracted like your granny when the priest was coming around and they spritz up the elf perfume for a special visitor. Unfortunately for them, that visitor is Emperor fucking Palpatine. He says that nothing is more important in securing the Empire's future than Project Necromancer and promises them unlimited finance and resources to assist. Omega and Crosshair work together to execute Plan 72, and Plan 72 seemingly is just run away from the monsters really quickly. Great plan, guy. It worked. Like, I can't argue with success, but I don't know if it needed to be put into a formal plan. Hemlock is pissed and releases the hounds, as well as locking Nala Se up until he learns that Omega's blood has a high M count and calls off the pursuit. And that was episodes 1, 2, and 3 of the third season of The Bad Batch. Jerry, we're back for one last time in The Bad Batch, and it feels really early for to be having these discussions around the show ending. I kind of want to get your thoughts on that first. Like, is this too soon? Because I feel like we're just getting to know these characters. I feel like season one, I watched all of this back, like, in advance of this, just so I'm kind of in that mind frame. And season one was a good show. It established the characters well. Obviously, they debuted in the last season of Clone Wars in the first arc, just to kind of introduce us, because they knew they were jumping off to this at some point. But again, season two was the first time that they really developed the characters and really got us to buy in and invest in them as people slash clones.
Yeah.
It feels so... I was disappointed to learn this is the last season, but again, like, they are ratcheting up the stakes to the point where you're like, I don't see how you could keep this going much longer. What are your thoughts on this being the last season?
I'm not happy that it's the last season, because I love the first two seasons. You know, you do get to love these characters like we loved the characters in Rebels, like we loved them in the Clone Wars. But I just, you know, Rebels and Clone Wars got a lot more seasons. And like, to only get three seasons, I in a way I can understand it, because in a, like, they're kind of just secondary characters in a way. Mm. In terms of the grand scheme of things. Now, obviously, there are things in, going on in this show that seem bigger.
Yeah.
And they're making it out that things are bigger. But I'm not happy with the fact that it's the last season. I love these characters. I do like, there was one thing I noticed, obviously we all noticed it, but I thought it was actually a nice touch. The fact that Omega just seems a little bit older with the long hair and stuff. And I'm like, that's actually quite good. But I need to know how long she's been there. I'm like, how long has she actually been there? What the hell is going on? I need to know how long that they've been apart. I thought it was a good start to the season. It wasn't too fast, wasn't too slow. You can, as you say, they're starting to ratchet up a little bit, and the stakes are getting a little bit higher now, because now she's, as we see, she's kind of on the run now. It's everything is kind of coming together. There are still a hell of a lot of questions. Obviously, we're going to discuss a few of them now, but yeah. I'm liking how it started. As I say, it's not too, wasn't too fast, wasn't too slow. I would have liked to see a little bit more, like a little bit more oomph too. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong with that, but for me, I'm just happy to have the show back.
Yeah.
And the fact that we got a three episode premiere, very happy with that, because we've now established a few things. My main man was in it again, Emperor Palpatine, back again. I did find it strange looking at him, though, because when he came off the shuttle, I'm like, he just looks weird. Mm. He just seemed really tall. Obviously, he's a thin man, but he just seemed really, really, okay. I'm going to say this in a nice way possible. He seemed very erect. He seemed very erect.
The word erect did not need to be there.
It absolutely needs to be there. He just seemed to stand too straight for me.
Palpatine seemed erect.
This is Star Wars. He's erect. absolutely erect. Put it this way, if you could make a 3D model of him as he was on that platform and sell it as a dildo. You absolutely could do that 100% because he was erect. There was something about
unlimited power. There you go.
It
only needs one battery.
Unlimited,
like.
Oh no, unlimited power when you plug it in. Absolutely.
Yeah, there you go.
But I think that the image of him just wasn't right. He seemed too tall. He wasn't. Normally he's like this old guy, feeble on the walking stick and hands kind of like this, and it just didn't seem like that. So it just the Emperor for me was weird. But to hear Ian McDermott back again, like, oh yeah, it just can't be anyone else. I know Sam Witwer did a little bit in Rebels, and then they actually replaced him with Ian McDermott, and then they dubbed him over again in the other episodes. But there is no Emperor like Ian McDermott. It's not. Just absolutely fantastic. Great to see him back. But again, him being there just brought those questions we're talking about, like, what the hell is going on? It's great to see, as I say, Omega, with the fact that she looks a little bit older now. She seems slightly more mature. I'm going to say slightly more mature. She's probably only there a couple of weeks or months, but she's slightly more mature. She's a bit more of a kind of head on her shoulders. It's good to see the other two, but it's very strange to see the other two just being the two of them. I wanted a little tiny bit more. Now, I thought the three episodes were great. They really were. I just wanted a tiny bit more. It was actually great to see young clones. I thought that was fantastic. And the fact, now, you know me, I am terrible with names. The fact that is it Daniel Logan? Played young Boba Fett in Attack of the Clones.
Right. I don't.
Well, the guy who played, the young lad who played young Boba Fett, the kid Boba Fett in Attack of the Clones, actually voiced one of them. So I thought that was a nice little callback as well. And then the other two were actually voiced by, again, don't know the guy's name, but he was the young lad from Deadpool 2.
Yeah. You there?
Yeah, so can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear.
Yeah, sorry. It was just nice to see, because obviously they have that kind of Aussie accent. that the other clones would have. So yeah, I thought overall I was very happy with it. I just wanted a little bit more. So what did you think?
I liked the fact that it was like, I think we were speaking about, you know, what do we think about it being the last season? And, you know, I think it's too early. I don't know. I'm willing to let it play out and see, because it doesn't seem like there's a lot of road left. And I think the one thing the Bad Batch do is they're like, They're kind of, it's a weird thing to say, they're safe to kill, if that makes sense, because they don't feature anywhere else in the timeline, and they have those kind of that, they have that warrior demeanor. I think Omega is the only one who seems bulletproof, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
They have stakes where you can, like, it makes sense for this to be a short show, but I'm just getting into it. And it's such a good show. I wonder if it's because of just ratings and it just has never got the buzz. It's very hard to find a Bad Batch fan. Like, it's very hard. You don't see, like, when Ahsoka was on, my entire TikTok just filled up with memes. That doesn't happen for the Bad Batch. And I hate that because I love it. It's such a good show. So I kind of wonder if it's to do with that. And like, maybe, but again, they're so good at telling this story that I trust them, and I trust them to bring it all together. It does seem like it's a natural ending for the story that we're building towards, whatever that may be. I'm just intrigued. Like, I'm willing to give it, like, judge it as a whole presentation, but I was emotionally upset when it ended. So let's get into it episode by episode anyway. So we start off with episode one, Confined, and that was just more of a character-based episode, which saw us focus on Omega and Crosshair in Mount Tatniss. With this, I kind of enjoyed Omega as kind of Crosshair's moral compass there. Like, obviously, he's on a redemption arc, and you kind of see him reckon with his past and be just broken as a human, but with guilt for everything he's done. I liked Hemlock as well. Like, the fact he was kind of like, he's got a touch of Tron to him, in that, like, he has intellect and unflappability, even in adversity, even when you think you get him, like when Omega released Batcher and he's like, why did he do that? Like, you just actually put him in danger. And it's like, every time we think, like Tron and Rebels, every time we think our heroes get one over on him, he just is like, why did you do that? I expected you to do that, and this is why you fucked up, you know what I mean? And he's just so unflappable. Like, it's kind of scary. Although there was the bit of vulnerability with the shaking hands that they kind of hinted at as well, so that's interesting too. But also as well, I kind of saw that I liked the symbolism of Hemlock trying to break Omega's optimism by telling her that, like, she'd killed Batcher and she'd actually led him to war, and he's trying to break her optimism. And you have, like, Omega has been the annoying kid that, like, you know, is in every, she's the Carol out of The Walking Dead at times, you know what I mean? And it's just like, yeah. Come on, like, why are we building all this around Omega? But I kind of see it now. She is the ray of hope in this despairing universe, you know what I mean? And again, consider the timeline that we're in. This is way before the original trilogy. This is, the Empire is just getting started at this stage. And there is no hope for the galaxy. So she is that hope. And I love the contrast that they had in this, where you have at one stage, like, she's trying to be hopeful and see the best in Crosshair. She always sees the best in people. She always saw Crosshair as her brother who'd just taken a wrong turn. And he's trying to put her off, and he's just trying to say, I'd leave you behind in a second. Like, just, this is where I belong. Leave me alone. She's trying to be hopeful and free Batcher. And then Hemlock is trying to break that in her and say, you see what you did? You actually just killed him. But the fact that Batcher was alive at the end, I love that, shows that there is hope, and that her hope is actually leading somewhere. And again, you know, you think of the first trilogy movie, A New Hope, and that's kind of that's a theme that ties into this era of Star Wars as well, where everything seems so horrifically bad, but there's just a ray of hope that kind of keeps everything together. And Omega is that. So what were your thoughts on the first episode? Kind of a quieter start for the series, just setting up the pieces more than anything.
I thought, you know, this was, when you're looking at it, it's obviously, you're looking at a child basically in prison, and she's going through her day-to-day routine, and she's trying to kind of get through the monotony. So the one thing that really kind of drew me to it was when she was going to the lab with her blood sample, and what was her name?
I have it here. Cara, I want to say Carr. Amira Carr, I think it is.
So she's almost a robot.
Mm.
You know, she's almost a robot. So it's like, you know, we have to do this because you have to do it, and that's as simple as that. And it's very routine, it's very regimented, and it's like they take the same route every day, they pass crosshairs at the exact same point every day. It's like, this is just over and over, it's just driving people crazy. Mm. But when she goes to the lab and she has the blood sample, she brought it in, and the Kaminoan, what was her name?
Nalase.
I wasn't going to say it the way you said it. And then she takes the blood sample and gets rid of it. You're like, oh, right, this is something. This is something. This is leading to something big. I thought, well, maybe she's going to be the one blood sample that's out. It's the fact that she's getting the blood sample every single day. So I was like, how has she not been caught? Like, what the hell? Like, oh, they're going to be caught. They're going to be fucking caught. They're all going to be caught. Jeez. It gives you kind of a little nervy thing. When she had the interaction as well with the creature, again, me with names, you know, she starts off and it's a bit more vicious, and then she's feeding it. And it's like, it just goes to show you exactly what type of character she has.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter whether she's a clone or not. She's her own person. She's her own unique personality. And it's starting to come true. You then see as she goes through the episode, the hair gets longer. And she's really, really trying with crosshairs. You're like, just, you know, like what you were saying there, there is always hope. She's really trying to bring it out in them. So it was a great start to it. I'm like, if we'd have just gotten that episode, I'd have been slightly disappointed. I needed more. So then you look at it, obviously, when you watch all three episodes, you're like, okay, that was actually the perfect starter.
Yeah.
Because you needed to see, it was never going to be the other lads coming in all guns blazing in the first episode. Of course it wasn't going to be that. That don't be silly. But it needed to set up, it needed to show us exactly where everybody was. So that's where she is. That's where Crosshairs is. Crosshairs is just defeated. He is given up. He's like, he doesn't care. You can see as he walks by her, he's just hunched over and he's just looking down, won't even look at her. It's like, yeah, it's just whatever, you know. I took the orders and look where I am now.
Yeah.
You know, and he's just so utterly, utterly defeated. But it's taking somebody, the optimism and hope of a child, to bring him back. And it was a great, great start, great first episode. Would I wanted that little bit more? Absolutely, but I don't think it wasn't a bad episode. It was a great episode.
Yeah.
And it was great. Just great to see them back. It really, really was. It's great to see the series back.
I loved the conversations the two of them had. Like, you know what I mean? And he's like, you know, he's telling her that not every clone is an ally. And she says, you don't trust enough, saying he won't give up on her. And he's saying, I belong here. Just really, really powerful stuff. Like, I loved it. Somewhat less powerful, if I'm going to be honest. I wasn't a big fan of episode 2, Paths Unknown. Kind of just a side mission with Wrecker and Hunter teaming with the huge Regs. Don't get me wrong. I found it interesting. Like, you know, I what these shows love. Like, this is a direct follow-on from the Clone Wars, to the point that it started with the Clone Wars kind of signature, and then it became its own show. But there's such compassion for clones, and I love this about Star Wars, where, you know, clones and droids are never treated as objects. They're always people. They always have individual personalities. They always have individual characteristics and so on. So I do like getting drip-fed things. And again, I'm not going to say that this is a bad episode, but I just feel like we only have 16 of these left, only 13 after this tree. So for me, this was more a BAU side adventure episode of the Bad Batch. So I wasn't crazy about the episode. If I'm being honest, I drifted quite a lot. Again, like, I may like this more in hindsight, because there was a part of me that's like, do you know what? Like, you know, there was a part of me that's like, fucking get on with it. Like, I know this is going nowhere. Like, and it didn't. Like, they're just like, oh, I'm going to leave you off of Pabu. And I'm like, okay, they actually got nowhere in their search. The start I liked, you know, where they kind of met with Lady Gunther, and she was dropping people through the moon door. And that was interesting and fun and different. And it kind of brought a bit of the darkness that, like, yeah, this... This is like what I like about the Bad Batch is it can get a bit dark at times. You know what I mean? It's not for kids, this show. It's quite dark and bleak at times. And I enjoyed that aspect of it, but also, like, maybe I'll enjoy it more at the end of the series, because maybe it was just the last one of these episodes where it's just an adventure of the week. It's just a side quest where they're kind of off just doing their things, and the Slytherin Vines, they're bringing us more into the universe and letting us enjoy that. I like spending time in the Star Wars universe, but I'm also like, okay, you've told me there's only 16 episodes of this. What the fuck? If I knew that this wasn't the last season, I wouldn't have cared. And if I would have been like happy to spend 20 minutes here, but like the plot is urgent now. Everything they do is urgent. So this fell a little bit flat for me and was just more an FYI. Here's where Hunter and Wrecker are. What were your thoughts on episode two? Do you think I'm being harsh? Do you think I'm being too downbeat in it? Or were you feeling the same?
I don't think you're being harsh. It definitely, when you look at all three episodes, it was definitely a downer in terms of all three. I think what you could have done was you could have had an extended first episode just to show you exactly where everybody was, not just where Omega was. So you could have had a cutback type of thing where they're doing their bit to try and find her, she's doing her bit to try and save Crosshairs, that type of thing. So it might have, even say a 40-minute episode where you just shown that everyone, like, they're trying to find her and she's trying to get out. And it probably would have been better. But I liked the first one. The second one definitely fell flat. One thing for me is whenever I'm watching something that it's specifically voice acting and I hear a voice that I think I recognize, I immediately have to go searching. I was like, the fuck was that? And I was very surprised when I found out that the crime boss, what you say her name was?
Lady Gunther, I want to say, I think.
That she is voiced, and I could not believe it when I heard this, Angelica Houston.
No way.
Yeah, voiced her. I was like,
class,
what the fuck? So that just goes to show you, these shows are absolutely filled to the rafters with the best actors you could possibly get. And the fact it was Angelica Houston was like, Jesus Christ, I knew I recognized the voice. I was like, where do I know that voice? And then you're like, Jesus, that is absolutely fantastic. In terms of the episode, it did fall flat. It really did. Okay, they were trying to find a way to find Omega. We get that, absolutely. They got the information from the crime boss. They went off and they realized it's actually a really old facility and they haven't been there in years. They had to get help from three young clones. It just didn't feel like that. It just didn't really go anywhere as such.
Yeah.
Okay, clearly they were there to save the three lads. That was the whole point of the episode. They were there to save the three clones. Did we need it? No. No, we could have had a thing where they actually started to zero in on her location properly, actually do it properly. But no, it fell flat ever so slightly. Obviously there was a little bit of action in it. I liked that. That was good. Yeah. But I was like, you know, it's one of those episodes where if you're doing a rewatch, you're like, don't need to watch. Let's skip it.
Yeah, you
and
would.
That's
literally
essentially
just
what it is. You'd skip it. You would. Now it was great to see them back. Really, really was. But it was a nonsense episode. It was. Yeah.
And like, again, what we're losing is like the kind of gravity and stakes of the situation they're in, having lost Omega, weighs on the character so much. But that is actually a bit shit TV because they're just sad. And then what you lose is kind of like every time Wrecker's on screen, Wrecker's one of my favorite characters in Star Wars. Like, he's just great crack, but like he can't be that now because he's got to be downbeat and he's got to be urgent and stuff like that as well. So like you then want to see Wrecker proper wrecking things and in action. And again, like kind of just having them do a generic adventure that they do. Again, these aren't bad episodes, but yeah, it just felt a bit random and out of place. But fortunately, this is a 3-episode premiere. And I usually hate 3-episode premieres. I hate them because I just feel it's so selfish of the creators to just be like, I'm going to take up all of your time and make it really difficult for you to find time to watch this. But this worked as a full story. You had the first episode, here's where these are in the second, and then you bring it all together and you really amp up the stakes. This is maybe the best episode of Bad Batch yet. It's up there. It was phenomenal. Shadows of Tantis ramped it up a lot. Yeah, like, and again, I thought this was fantastic. Palpatine, like, being inserted into this gives it all the stakes in the world in the bigger picture. Because obviously he's coming in and saying Project Necromancer. And by the way, if that name sounds familiar, obviously it was referenced in the last season, but it was also referenced in the last Mandalorian season in the discussion around Tron. But, you know, Palpy coming in and saying there's nothing of greater importance to secure the future of this empire. Whatever's needed to accomplish this goal, you will have it. Again, that just gives us the stakes. But what I like about this show is they parachute Palpy in to kind of gives us like, okay, this matters to the big picture. And what our characters do really plays a role in what's eventually to come, for better or for worse. But then they've circled back to the character story. They literally just parachute Palpy out of there. He comes in, says a couple of lines, raises the stakes, and then just goes. And now we're focused on Omega and Crosshair's escape. And I thought that was great. I love, like, kind of where we left it as well. Like, you have, you know, Hemlock, and like, he's kind of like in this great position, like, perhaps possibly more valuable to the Empire right now than even Vader would be. You've got, but also he has the shaking hand that he's trying to keep a secret as well. You've got Kara, and you're wondering, could she be turned? Technically, she calls herself Omega's sister. There's kind of hints of that there. You've got Nala Se in danger. You've got Crosshair and Omega. What a way to leave us. I love this episode. It was fantastic. What were your thoughts?
Absolutely loved it. You knew something was up before you heard about Palpatine getting there, before you saw Palpatine get there. You knew something was up because there was fucking clones and stormtroopers everywhere. You're like, what the hell is going on? The first episode, you're seeing a couple of lads standing at doors. You're seeing a couple of them escorting prisoners around. That's it. Now you're seeing literally dozens and dozens of people. And you're like, there's shit going down. And I even said to myself, I was like, oh, we're going to get a visitor. We're going to get somebody in here. This is important. Like, somebody's coming. And then, of course, it's confirmed it's Palpatine is on his way. I'm like, oh, yes. I love Ian McDermott. He's absolutely fantastic. So what I find very interesting is, obviously, this guy is a cloner, or, you know, this is what he does, but he has an extreme amount of the commandos. Like, he has fucking loads of them. I'm like, Jesus, I didn't think there was that many. He doesn't use any normal clones. He only uses the clone commandos. I'm like, Jesus Christ, this is extortionate. And then, of course, you have the new style stormtroopers, or should I say, it's supposed to be the old style, because we have the new one. You know what I mean? We have the new stormtroopers there. Then he arrives, and it's just like, okay, show me what you've been up to. Show me what you're doing. I'm like, just hook this fucking Palpatine shit to my veins. Absolutely love it. But then it starts to get, you see that the threat level is now far increased, because number one, Omega sample hasn't been trashed. It's now been put in the fucking machine. That's only a matter of time before it's actually scanned and they realize what it is. We get them. We get the Emperor walking through, and you're coming to the laboratory with the kind of the ratios, the orange ratios. Like, I want to see what the fuck is going on in here. I want to see. And they're such fuckers. They only give you little hints, and you see a chamber opening up, but you don't see anything. You're like, you bastards, just show me what it is, you fuckers. Absolutely loved it. The Emperor, when he said that line, anything you want basically is yours, and you can just see the smile on his face when the Emperor says that. You're like, oh, this fucker, literally whatever he wants is his. You never heard the Emperor say that to Director Krennic, or Darth Vader, or Tron, or even Graham off target. Never, ever said that to anybody else. He would fight with them over resources. He would let them fight amongst each other for resources. But this guy, no. You, my friend, have whatever the fuck you want. So very, very, and it's very, very clear that whatever this is so important to the Emperor that nothing else matters. And you're like, that's where the stakes are. So we're getting through the episode, and then Omega's like, right, we need to get the fuck out of here. I have this special pad now. I have this special pad that's going to let me to go doing whatever the hell I want. Let's go get Crosshairs. I'm like, oh, yes. I'm like, Crosshairs, please don't be a dick. Please don't be a dick. Just go with her. And we get the escape. I'm like, yes! They're running through that fucking tunnel. And for a split second, I'm like, she's going to get trapped. She's going to get trapped. She's going to get trapped. He's going to escape. I had it in my head. He's going to escape. She's going to get trapped. He's going to go. No. He's not going to ditch her. He will run, absolutely. But he'll go and find the other two.
Yeah.
And then it'll be a team effort. Let's go and get her. When that happened, I'm like, I was ever so slightly disappointed. I'm like, that kind of brought the threat level up even more because now they know she has the midichlorians. Now they know that they have her. And I'm like, oh. So it would have kind of, my anxiety would have went up a little bit more. And yeah. I kind of, when you have a show like this, that's what you want to happen. You don't want to be just sitting there going, yeah, this is good. You want to like, Don't. Oh, you bastard. That's exactly what you want in a show like this. And that's kind of what we got. So it's just fantastic to see kind of her pet then kind of still being alive and howling. I'd imagine howling. The Emperor just kind of flitters off. He's fucking gone. You know, just let me know when you have more progress made. From the end of this episode, I'm like, right, now I'm invested. I wasn't 100% in the first episode. I thought the first episode was good. My interest dipped way down in the second episode, and then it just went through the roof at the end of the third episode. I'm like, right, I'm in, lads. Give me the 13 more episodes now. Hook the shit to my veins. I will binge watch you, and I'll give you my verdict at 6 o'clock in the morning. That's what I wanted. We're obviously not going to get that. We're going to be drip fed fucking episodes for the next 13 weeks.
Yeah.
But you know what? This is exactly what they do because they now have guaranteed you're coming back every single Wednesday to watch this show because you're now hooked. You weren't hooked in the first episode. You weren't hooked in the second episode. But by Jesus, they hooked you in the third one. That's why they did three episodes because they knew the first two wouldn't cut it. They had to do that third one because that's where the hook came in. You are being reeled in by the fisherman, which is Dave Filoni right now. And we're all in for this. It's going to be exciting to see exactly where it goes. Now, the only thing I'm thinking is, we've gotten to this point in three episodes. What's actually going to happen in 13 episodes?
So this is what I wanted to discuss. I wanted to discuss two things, okay? And I want to get on to theories.
Yeah.
But first, what I wanted to discuss is kind of what you touched on there. The stakes are now high. And Palpatine has given Hemlock assurances. And again, Hemlock is someone, he's a show original. And he's given him assurances that, no, we've never seen Palpatine give anyone. He is the top boy in the Empire right now. It's because he's running Project Necromancer. It's not so much a mystery, but we just don't know what it is. But we can kind of do the maths. But we don't have that confirmed. And we don't know, people are kind of saying that, look, this is ultimately, they're trying to make sense of episode 9. They're eventually looking at getting to cloning, but can you clone people with midichlorians and stuff like that as well? What's your take on what Project Necromancer is? What do you think has Palpatine banking the future of the Empire on?
This is where it gets confusing for me because I can theorize, I can guess, but I know I'm wrong because I have no fucking clue. Obviously, right, Necromancer has to do with the fact that Palpatine wanted to clone himself.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. He wanted to clone himself. But this is what I don't understand. Palpatine, if he just cloned himself, he has a really high midichlorian count. So surely that should be enough for the clone. Mm. So why do they need Omega's blood, Omega's midichlorian count? it doesn't actually matter what her midichlorian count is, because Palpatine is one of the most powerful beings in the entire universe. So is it because is her midichlorian count so through the roof that you're like, he wants to incorporate his essence into a body that has a high midichlorian count that high? Or is this something completely different? And it's so throwing me, I have the clue what's going on.
Do we know that clones can't, like, that? Do we know that if you just clone Palpatine right now that his midichlorians would transfer? I don't think we do. So I think that's what it is. I think they're trying to prove that. Like, this theory's going around, and the more we get into it, the more worrying it is that people are saying that, like, Omega is Rey's grandparents, you know what I mean? And there's connections there, obviously, because there's, or there's something in there, like, somehow. Again, there's a lot of weird theories going around there, but we don't know. So I think that's what it is, to be honest. If I'm guessing, it's the fact that they can't transfer like, they can clone Palpatine and they can get someone who looks like him and acts like him and talks like him, but they're not Palpatine. So you need that clone, you need that, like, essentially. And for those who don't know, like, if anyone's, like, not Star Wars literate, again, in that sense, midichlorian means Omega's going to be close with the Force. We haven't really seen much with that. But that's going to come into play as time goes on. Yeah. It's interesting because we've seen Ventress in the, like, a big Clone Wars favorite. Yeah. We've seen her, and that's someone who, again, is not a Jedi, but is very strong with the Force. She's someone who, again, against type, has Force powers, you know. So
I think you've touched on something there, and it just kind of popped when you said it, popped into my head. If you were to clone Palpatine, maybe they probably have done that and something wasn't right.
Yeah.
Whereas Omega is a clone. She's already a clone. So it was like, how do we... Okay, so we've now made a clone that has midichlorians. So how do we replicate this?
Yeah.
So I think that might be...
That's what the project seems to be, yeah.
But when you think of Necromancer, okay, the idea of Necromancer is bringing something back from the dead.
Yeah.
That's what Necromancy is. So it's essentially what it is. It's about making sure that the Emperor will be able to live forever. And this is not something that is unique to just this, these Star Wars shows and films and whatnot. When it comes to the old books, the old canon, stuff like that, that, you know, he did it multiple times. He had multiple clones of himself made. He had clones of Luke Skywalker made. He wanted to live forever no matter what. And he had all these clones made. So that's obviously where the idea is coming from for the new canon. Exactly what it is, we just don't know yet. We're going to find out a lot more by the end of the show. But I think we're not going to find the full story yet because they mentioned Project Necromancer in the last season of The Mandalorian. I want you to think about this for a second. So Project Necromancer, last season of that, right? Ahsoka. Okay, we're now on Dathomir with the likes of Thrawn and the Night Sisters. I'm sorry, what do they do? They bring things back to life, don't they?
Yeah,
the whole fucking thing is tied together. So we're not by the end of these 13 episodes or whatever it is, we're not going to find out the full story. We're going to get little hints and little things, but that's exactly what Dave Filoni and Star Wars does. They give you a little bit. A little nugget to keep you interested for the next series that comes out, until finally the big reveal. So the Project Necromancy is going to run side by side with the Dathomiri and with the bringing people back to... Oh, I tell you, it's all connected.
Yeah, and the difference in timeline, for those not kind of keeping score, again, you're talking Ahsoka set fairly long after the trilogy, to the point that the Empire is kind of well defeated and we're watching almost a new Republic crumble. This set very much at the start. So we're seeing the start of Project Necromancer, but whatever happens here, that is going to continue through the original trilogy and go on to exist and then only really come into play in the sequel trilogy, which, again, like, you know, I respect Dave Filoni and what he does. And of course he came to fame with the Clone Wars, which obviously was a way to make sense of a lot of the interesting themes that were explored but not executed very well in possibly the worst of the nine kind of Skywalker saga movies, Attack of the Clones. And that's what he exists to do. That's what he loves to do. He loves to make sense of the shite. I don't know if many people were asking for this much of the lore to be devoted to that plot point, that we'd probably just rather forget somehow Palpatine returned. He's like, I'm going to tell you that. Like, he's like, that's somehow, I'm going to take that ball and run with it. But I'm interested. Look, I want to hear it out. Like, again, I don't know if it was a question anyone was necessarily asking or needing, but if he can pull it off, Jesus Christ, that's another huge win. I am intrigued, like, because again, it has it, but the fact that we know the ending of it, I don't know, kind of spoils it a little, because it's like, okay, so we know that Palpatine returned, you're explaining what the somehow is, and that's great. But then again, like, I don't know, like, Star Wars is a way of, like, making these questions worth. We know that Anakin became Darth Vader, but it was still fucking thrilling to watch it happen in Revenge of the Sith. So, like, yeah. I'm in, I'll watch it. But, yeah. Like, again, there's just part of me that's like, yeah, I know, he returned and it's shit. And at the end of this, when I watch all of this amazing stuff that leads up to it, the end of it is me having to rewatch that really shit movie.
when it comes to this, though, with the Project Necromancer, obviously we heard about it first in that last season of Mandalorian, and then we saw the other clones that were in that, all in the back to tanks, right in the last episode of the Mandalorian. So it's not just the Emperor that has this fascination with cloning. You've then got when Thrawn gets back to Dathomir, you've got those witches, he's got all those coffins. I think it's starting to be more clear what they are. And things are going to be brought back to life. So I don't think necessarily it's just about the Emperor now. I don't think it's just about, oh, that's how the Emperor got back. It's a bigger picture here now. There is one thing I want to say, though, and it has been these characters in The Bad Batch, every one of them, obviously not the Emperor, but every one of the main characters in this are expendable. Even Omega. Omega's expendable as well. Yeah. But could we, in fact, be getting our first show, and this is darker than the other shows. It's darker than Rebels. It's darker than Clone Wars. Maybe that, you know, maybe might be on par with that last season of Clone Wars in terms of darkness. Could we actually be getting our first Star Wars series that doesn't actually have a happy ending? That's something that's been sticking in my head. I think it's not obvious, but I think it's a huge possibility that all three of our Clone Force 99 are gone.
Is dark.
Yeah, I think they're all gone. Omega might get away. But I just have this feeling we're going to get a bad, not a bad ending. We don't want a bad ending, but not a happy ending. And I'm like, okay, I don't think we're getting a happy ending here.
We're getting into theories, so let's do it. Like, in terms of that, like, okay, so my own, if I was to write kind of what I think is going to happen, I would say Crosshair not making it to the end of the season, but is going to go down in a heroic way. Echo, I would say, is very unlikely. He is pretty much held together by sticky glue as it is. You know what I mean? Like, he's his suit is blue tacked onto him, and that is what's keeping him alive. So, yeah, I'd say that's going to be something there. I think realistically, like, what I really don't want to see, and I don't think we're going to see, is, And don't get me wrong, I don't want Tech dead, but his death in the last series was one of the most powerful and affecting deaths that I've had in Star Wars. It was heartbreaking and totally unexpected and really, really well executed. Technically, we never saw a body. We saw his goggles there. So again, that would suggest that a body exists somewhere that we haven't seen. But I don't want them to go back on that. I really, really hope they don't. And we get everyone surviving in the end. I think Echo, Hunter, and Wrecker, I think they all have fairly good odds to make it, go the distance, and then end up like creating a life in Pabu. Although the fact that they've already kind of signposted that that's what they want to do kind of indicates that it probably won't be what they get to do. You know, maybe one of them will, maybe Omega will or something like that. Or they have to hide her there or something. I don't know. There's a few other things that I kind of want to know, and I don't really have theories for these, but I just, these are the kind of questions that I'd like to see answered. Like, we talked about Ventress there. It looks like we're getting the Jedi version of Ventress, who we've never really had before, except in kind of Legends. And again, kind of, you know, she had an illicit love affair with kind of Quinlan Vos. Again, very toxic relationship, but there's a lot going on there. And that seems to be the version that we're getting of Ventress, which she's never actually seen play out in television before. So I'm excited for that. We know the clones at some stage get decommissioned. I feel that we're going to see how that works here. Like, that seems to be what this is pointing towards, because, again, the Empire is turning very anti-clone at the moment. I'd love another check-in with Kanan Jarrus. I don't see how it would play into the storyline, but it obviously started the series. So I'd love to just get another look at it. Like, Kanan's Jedi life and kind of the gap between what we saw at the start of the Bad Batch and who we met in Rebels. There's a huge gap there that we don't need to have everything filled out. You can just give us glimpses and we can imagine it and, like, talk about it among ourselves forever. Echo, I don't think, is long for this world, but we also have Rex and Cody in here. They're in the mix. They're on the way. You know what I mean? Like, on one hand, I would like to see, because we don't know what happened to them. We've no idea. In some very similar sense to Ahsoka. And in the Ahsoka series, there's no real mention of Rex beyond, like, we saw, like, a clip of them in, like, the Clone Wars throwback, but that was a flashback or a dream or however you want to kind of perceive it. Ahsoka never at any stage instinctually called for him, despite all of the trouble and all the backup she needed. She never called on the one person who would definitely be there for her if he got the call. So that worries me. And I think Rex is someone that, in particular, like, but also, like, again, Cody and Echo are the same, that need an ending. I worry we're going to get it here. It will break me if we do. But I do not want to know what happens. But I would also be very happy if he showed up as a really elderly clone in Mando Ahsoka. Sorry, I tell a lie. He's in Rebels.
Yeah, I was. I'm
okay, no, sorry.
I was literally waiting for you to stop
totally
talking.
Like, I was totally forgetting. Rex, he's in Rebels. We're all good. We're good.
He's in Rebels. He's but an, like, older guy in Rebels. But we're gonna obviously get, Cody is not.
Cody's not. Yeah, Cody seems like Cody's storyline seems set up for that. Echo's not in Rebels either, so yeah, Echo's gone. Sorry, Echo, or RIP. Yeah, I think we're gonna see, like, Omega's gonna end up having a connection to Palpatine, like a fucked up, like, she is there, like, she's the reason he gets cloned or something like that as well. It's gonna be messed up. And it's going to be, I hope it's a bit twisted. I think the show has the balls to be as well, because it's kind of playing off in its own little field. It doesn't have to be fan servicey like Ahsoka. It doesn't have to please a wider audience. And, like, it can just be niche and messy and kind of weird. And that's what I want these shows to be. That's kind of what the questions I'm looking for. What do you need to see? What do you want to see? Have you any theories? What's going on in your mind for the rest of the season?
Well, I want to see something that we know is going to happen, and that's getting the band back together. We know we're getting the band back together in some way. They're going to be helped by others. So we've got the other clones possibly coming in and giving them a gig dig out. We've got Ventress. Oh, sweet Jesus, that's going to be great.
Yeah.
Now, is it just going to be a half an episode type thing, or is she going to be in it for a few episodes? I'm hoping it's a few episodes. I really do. Looking at her, she's obviously a little bit different. The lightsabers are different, by the way. I like the new look. There was something about her from the Clone Wars. She was just a sassy fucker. Mm. And I'm like, yeah, I want to see that again. And I just think it's going to be absolutely fantastic. I think it could be a kind of a climactic thing. It's kind of like everyone joining forces to kind of help. And I would love to see that. Listen, not everyone's getting out of this show alive. And we know that for a fact. Even though we don't know it, but we know it. We know it. Not everyone's getting out of this alive. Do I think they're going to have that happy life on the planet with the other young clones? No, not all of them. If they do, if it's somehow like she gets to live out her life there, away from the Empire, away from everything, you know, that would be great. It'd be fucking shit, but it would be great, because I'd like to see, like, no, that has to be more substance to this. There has to be something. You can't just give us three seasons of somebody who, like a force sensitive clone, and not do anything with it. Mm. There has to be something you have to do with it. Don't know what, just give me something. And Filoni is great for stuff like this. Look what he did with Rebels. Look what he did with Clone Wars. He's cooking here. Just let him go. Obviously, I want to see Hemlock get to fuck.
Yeah, 100%.
But I need to know before he's about to.
Yeah.
What's going on? What's going on here?
I will learn all that.
There's something. And I'm like, but I feel like we should know. I feel like we should know about this. We should know the reason. And it's itching the back of my head. I'm like, why should I know this? Like, I just feel like it's some sort of connection. It's great. I like what you said there about like the decommission and the clones. We're not talking about the clones getting killed.
Mm.
Now, I think a lot of them will be.
Yeah.
Because we've seen that already. But when you look at the likes of the Obi-Wan show, we saw a down on his luck homeless clone begging on the street. So clearly not all the clones were killed. So what happens to them? What are they going to do with it? Are we just going to say, right, you're done, good luck?
I think we're going to see, like, I think there's going to be an attempted genocide.
I think so.
I don't think there's like a big master off switch to Palpatine compulsion. Obviously, we know that because, again, Rebels, like, again, Obi-Wan, we've seen those things. But in every one of those scenes, the clones are all in exile or they're all destitute. You know what I mean? So that's the one thing that we're seeing. So, again, I think you're talking in Order 66. Like, again, they all essentially, Obi-Wan's an interesting one to bring up because they all essentially become Obi-Wan, you know what I mean, in hiding, like having to hide their identity as well. And they're the most recognizable faces in the galaxy as well. So it's a really difficult existence. But I think, we may have a clone Order 66 coming up, and then there may be people who survive. But I think there's going to be a lot of, I think we're going to see that.
There are literally tens of thousands of clones.
Mm.
And the only reason they're still there is because the numbers of stormtroopers haven't exceeded them yet. So are we now going to see the numbers of stormtroopers exceed them? And that's when the Empire doesn't need the clones anymore, because that's essentially it.
Yeah,
he'll only get rid of the clones when he doesn't need them. So if he has an army big enough to take over from them, that's when he'll get rid of them.
Mm.
Is it something in the way of, like, as you said, our Order 66? Do they have in that chip that they all have? Is there a command to say, you know, throw yourself off a cliff? Mm. That type of thing. I'm like, Jesus, I hope we don't see that. But there has to be something. I think the idea of an Order 66, clone Order 66, Jesus, that's... It's just dark enough for this show, I think.
Yeah.
It is dark enough for this show. And I think there's a very big possibility. And I could see, with the band getting back together, them trying to help clones, with the likes of Rex and Cody and Echo and the rest of the lads trying to help as many clones as they possibly can. Now, I've that's just come out of my mouth. I'm like, that's how we bulk out this season.
Mm.
That's how the season gets bulked out.
Yeah.
Because they're doing this whole clone. The clone thing is not to make a new army. The clone thing is to do with Palpatine. And we know that. And, you know, we don't know the ins and outs and the details of it. But we know it. Because there's no way he would be... Like, who is he trying to bring back to life? Nobody. He's not trying to bring anyone back to life. He wants to make sure he lives forever. It's not about bringing anyone... He's not bringing his old master. Yeah, you know, Plagueis. He's not bringing him back. You know, I had a mad thought in my head earlier on. I was like, nah, it's not. So it would be one of those really out there things. Is he trying to create a new body for Vader? I'm like, no, he wouldn't be. He's not doing that.
He wouldn't care enough.
He wouldn't give it.
Vader
he wants Vader to be angry. And when Vader's in that suit, he's in pain and he's angry. And that's where where the dark side comes from. So that's what he wants. So I immediately kind of put that to one side. But it's just one of those out there kind of mental things. But clearly, anything to do with cloning and anything to do with this necromancer thing has Palpatine come, just him written all over it. And it's him trying to be able to create a perfect body for him to inhabit if something happens to him.
Mm.
Exactly what it is, I don't know. Exactly why we need... I think the only reason where he's trying to clone... If, let's say, he tried to clone himself. So he creates a clone, but this clone doesn't have the midichlorians. It doesn't have any force abilities whatsoever. Whereas we now have a clone that has force abilities. So if they can clone a clone that has force abilities or find out exactly why she has it, and then we can create a clone that has midichlorians, as many as you fucking want, you know, and make himself even more powerful.
Yeah.
That's the type of thing that Palpatine's thinking about. That's the type of thing that Palpatine will throw everything at to make sure that he is the Emperor forever, he's going to live forever, and he has full control. It's very interesting to see where it's going to go. But this, I'm excited. Mm. I am very much excited. We've got Project Necromancer. We've got the clones coming back together, and they are going to come back together eventually. We have all these other characters from the first two seasons coming back as well, and we have familiar characters coming back from the likes of Clone Wars and Rebels. I am very excited for this. I'm very excited to see where it goes. We are going to get more episodes like episode 2. I'm just putting that out there. We are getting episodes in this. It's going to happen. It happened with Mando. It happened with Ahsoka. It happened in Clone Wars, and it happened in Rebels. You're going to get it in this as well. So we have to be prepared for that. But ultimately, it's going to be fleshed out with this, whatever the storyline is with Necromancer, whatever we're going to do with Omega, it's going to be fleshed out with that. I'm excited to see where it goes. I'm looking forward to for the next few weeks to see exactly what happens. And it's exciting.
Like, is it though? Is it exciting, or should we be excited, or should we be dreading it? Because I want to remind you something. The end of season one ended with the destruction of a planet and a genocide in Kaminoa. And then you've got but then you've got season two, Tech dying. I think you're hitting the nail on the head. We're going to be traumatized by this show.
Oh, this ending 100%, yeah.
But it is ballsy. It is really good storytelling. It is pushing the boundaries in the way that shows like Mando and Ahsoka are almost afraid to now, because they're trying to please a bigger audience. This is for us. And that's what we're going to love. We're not going to be discussing this every single week. Because again, look, imagine we got episode 2. What would we talk about? It'd be a 5-minute episode of Star Jair. So we find a way to make it 2 hours. Don't worry. We will be catching up throughout the season, and later in the season in particular, as we kind of head towards the conclusion. Because again, there's going to be a lot to discuss. So don't worry, we'll be back. Jerry, it's been too long. We're not going to leave it this long. Until the next time. Always a pleasure. I know myself and everyone else will also be really excited that you will be back at the Loblaws parties. And it's great to have you anytime here on Page 180. Thanks for joining us today.
Cheers, sir.